Welcome everyone to the session Automating the Known Unknown by Sagar and Joel. We are glad that they could join us today, and without any further delay, over to you guys.
Thanks Nidhi for letting us in. So hi guys, myself Sagar. I am currently working as Senior Manager SJIT as part of Jio, and I have over a decade of years of experience in the test automation and testing space. I would also love to get my colleague Joel introduced. Joel, can you please introduce yourself?
Hi everyone, welcome to the session. I'm Joel Rosario. I'm working with Exensio as a consultant for Jio, and I have around 18 years of experience in the tech space.
Okay, so thanks Joel for the short introduction, and okay, welcome on board everyone for the case study we are going to present, Automating the Known Unknown. So myself and Joel would be driving you through this entire session or case study, what you can call. Before we get into any more details, I just want you to give a overview on what is a 30,000 feet view of our application or system which we are testing, to get the complexity involved while testing such a big application or a component. So we have all set of client applications. We have an edge layer which deals with, we have number of microservices, components such as consumers, producers, Kafka, n number of databases, Elasticsearch, cache, and the most problematic area where we would be talking more on this session are the external systems, which are on the extreme right hand side of the diagram. They represent all the external systems or external entities the application under test interacts with. Now, look, I just want all of you to, because I'm very sure that you all also have such complex systems where you test. So can you just give me on the chat window, what are different type of known unknowns you think of, or what do you understand from what are the known unknowns? Can you please try to write down things on chat? Currently, I'm not seeing any chat coming in. Guys, please let it be interactive. So I'll just give you a hint. Okay, third-party dependencies. I can see Gaurav typing in. Thanks, Gaurav, for that input. Negative scenarios from third party. Yes, exactly. That is what we would be talking of. And Joel would be your point person of contact, helping you know how these things we have done. Okay, so I think we got quite a flakiness of test, I don't think is a known unknown. Flakiness of test is something which is part of test design we need to take care of. But this known unknowns make flaky test. Testing 500 responses from third party, race conditions. Yeah, quite a lot of good inputs coming from people. And thanks for typing this down. But if on a broader level, if I try to bucketize whatever inputs we had so far, so these can be considered as, like, we have to test application when the upstream system goes down. This typically depicts the 500 scenarios which some of you were talking about. Testing applications when there is a timeout from external systems. These are like mostly the third party dependencies where we talk of ki third party gives timeout, doesn't respond in time. Then one interesting fact is sometimes we have to test our application. Our application services are ready, but the upstream systems are not yet ready. So we cannot go about testing such scenarios. And this point is like my favorite, because there are scenarios when you have to test only few of the API fails, not the entire, all the APIs for a service tends to fail. Very difficult scenario to automate in integration and other environments, and requires a lot of collaboration efforts. And lastly, validating timeout negative scenarios on UI, which again has dependencies on external systems whom we interact with. So throughout this case study or this session, we would be talking on these unknowns, how we tackle them as part of Jio. Now, when I bring the pointers of like these are tests which we need to automate or these are known unknowns, everybody talks of mocking. Okay, we can use a fake server and it will solve our problem. And most of the world uses fake in a manner where they have API tests for each of different services and they communicate independently to the mock server, take response, and we check behavior of each and every service. And same happens for front end. Now, why I have kept backend and front end as separate entity? Because as shown in the diagram as well, we have an edge layer which deals with the internal services, and then internal services deals with the external services in an ecosystem. So the mocks and the interfaces for front end and back end might differ a while or a bit. So that's where we have separate API test and API mock servers and back end test and back end mock server. Now, quickly, people can again go back to their chat windows and type what challenge they think this approach might bring to them, or if they have faced any such challenges as part of their experience. Sorry for making you type, but if you can please again help me out with certain thoughts on this. What do you think is a challenge if you test this way? Okay, change of API contract as part of new feature. Good. Mock not updated, same as like change of API contract. Test data, good call out, Weber. Test data is like really a painful activity while we do this kind of mocks. Not all data set can be tested. I a little bit disagree to this point that not all data set can be tested, because mock provide you that flexibility to test all different type of data. But if required, we can have a detailed discussion in the Hangout, which Nidhi would be introducing in some post this session. How do you test your mock? This is an interesting question. Yes. How do you test your mock? So please be patient for this question, at least how we test the mock itself. In a while, I will hand it over to Joel, who is like kind of expert on service virtualization and mocking. He is an active contributor to Specmatic tool itself, which also will come in a while. So I think we have got quite a good inputs. But as per our experience, what we have encountered, the very first drawback of this approach is we create separate tests for front end and back end. And that in like that involves or brings in maintenance and other aspects to it. Secondly, the integration of front end and back end gets only tested in a higher environment, which is again what is not desired as part of Geo or as part of the agile methodology. We want to shift left and have this interaction tested as early as possible. And like as Sam has mentioned, key static mocks, test data preparation, these are all like our maintenance heavy activities, need a lot of planning, strategizing and stuff. And as the application scales, maintenance of mocks also adds complexity to it. But the interesting point which we want to highlight is mocks or static mocks are not intelligent enough to validate the incoming request, because mostly the mocks are configured to take a request and provide a response. So they don't actually validate either the schema or the validate the genuineness of an incoming request. I will just take a while to tell you one of the scenario wherein we were following similar mocking approach and the front end application somehow converted an integer value to a floating point value, that it added a .00 to the input value. So the mock test, everything passed because server was expecting a field called as pin code. It got that field. Mock worked. We went to higher environment, but there the backend services failed because they were expecting a pin code like 400709, but they were getting an input 4009.00. And that's where an intelligent mock, which can validate incoming requests, is pretty much important. And we would be talking on that as well during our talk. Overhead of mocks stubs for internal services is something similar to static mocks are maintenance heavy, But as we have a lot of interaction between services and client interaction to services, we have to create an overhead of internal service mocking as well. Clean this. Yes. Now I will not take a, because I will again take this slide post when my, like when I continue this session. But if you can, like if you check this diagram as compared to what we showed earlier, so you can see now everything which was on the right hand side is stubbed using a tool called as Specmatic, which supports intelligent or dynamic runtime mocking that the test itself can handle. So if you can see a dotted line which goes to the Specmatic server, which sets dynamic stubs or dynamic responses, and the end-to-end ecosystem works. So when we see the demo and move to the next part of this, I will take you through this in more detail. But currently I would just want to hand over things to Joel so he can take you on a journey of service virtualization ahead. Joel, can you please take over?
Yeah. Thanks, Sagar. I need you to stop sharing.
Yes.
Right. Thanks. So taking over from where Sagar left off on this slide, just to reiterate briefly, we've created a special environment in which we deploy the key services in the center. The services to the right, which include things like Mass and Novelbox and other such things, everything in the peach boxes is basically not in that environment, but has been stubbed out using a tool called Specmatic, or mocked if you want. I believe this is how, just to sort of simplify that diagram, reduce it to its minimum or smallest, simplest possible version. This is what we typically do, right? Your simulated API, the service virtualization tool, is a way by which you can simulate all those APIs instead of actually having them in your environment. And your isolated test environment is just meant for testing the clients or the consumers of those APIs. And your tests will set up state on the simulations. They will take care of that, and then they will run. There are several benefits that this confers. They are lightweight. You can simulate any number of dependencies without expensive test setup, right? Because you can't really, if you're going to run in an isolated environment, you can't really have all the APIs that you're using set up locally. That's not easy. The only way to do that is simulate. It's really fast. There's no downtime. You have complete control of state setup. The drawback here, as some people have already pointed out in the chat, is that these simulations, while being really fast and light and easy to set up and all of that, these simulations can go out of sync with the actual API. So the simulation can go out of sync with the simulated. And then again, you know, we will end up getting a bunch of integration errors when we put the consumer and the API in an integrated environment for the first time. And that's not good, because the higher the environment, the longer it takes to resolve these kinds of errors. And we really want to shift left. We want to get these errors as early as possible. In fact, we want to even get it in our development environment on the laptop, you know, before it even gets deployed. And how do we do that? This is a problem in which you must somehow nail down the interaction between your simulated API and the simulation. The simulation itself. This is what we are calling contract-driven development. Contract-driven development means before you even start building the consumer, before you even start building the API, you actually start with the contract. And I'll just give you a small example of a contract. A contract basically contains all the details about the structure of your API. Open API is the industry standard for describing HTTP APIs. And there's a lot of rich detail that the Open API spec can contain. So I've shown you here on the screen a small sample file that contains an Open API specification for a sample application we'll come to later, an order API. You can see the products, right? There's a path for product slash ID, which means it takes slash product slash 10, for example, might give you details of order ID 10. What that looks like, what the structure will look like, the JSON request might have certain keys, the response might have certain keys, headers, you know, you expect certain headers to be there. What method will you use? There's a get, there's a post, there's a delete. There is so much information, right? This is complex stuff, you know, it's, and you can put all of that in the contract. And this is not a document. This is an executable specification. I say that because it is important to execute these, right? It is always easy to read a document and, you know, make a mistake, but it's important to be able to execute them. And that is how you get the feedback. The contract then validates the expectations of the consumer, of how the API would behave. And it also validates that the API is actually honoring those expectations and is not going to break any consumers. And so typically your architect or probably, you know, a developer or maybe someone from, you know, QA, whoever it is, will start off by writing a contract, something like what I showed you above. And once that is done, that is when the consumer developer starts building the component and they start to use the contract to simulate the upstream API, right? And by using the contract, you know, you can't just simulate anything. If my API is expecting to receive a JSON object, but I'm trying to send an XML, you know, the contract will break. If the API is expecting to receive a string, an IS string ID, but I'm trying to send an integer, the contract will validate that. I'll show you some examples of this later. And in the same way, the API developer also uses contract tests driven from the same contract. So if you realize, the contract actually contains all this structural information. It contains everything from what the, you know, request should contain in the payload, what the header should be, what the path should be, so on and so forth. All we've got to do is add actual values. And now you have an HTTP request. And you can take the HTTP request, hit the API, and get a response back. And now the contract also tells you what the response would look like. You can validate that too using the contract. So this contract becomes a single point of like a guardrail. You lay down that guardrail first, and then you start development. And now you start development independently. So consumer can start anytime. Provider, the API can start anytime. Doesn't matter, because the consumer can simulate the API accurately whenever it wishes. The API itself can effectively simulate the consumer using contract tests. And there's a whole class of errors that gets eliminated just by doing this, so that when you deploy in the integrated environment, you don't get these problems. In Jio, we are using an open source tool that Sagar has referred to before called Specmatic, which is a project on GitHub. It's open source, and we invite you to take a look and, you know, look at contribute if possible. But it essentially handles both the simulated the simulations, that's your service virtualization, and running contract tests. You just feed it a contract. I will show you a demo of how this works later. So just taking a quick deep dive into service virtualization, right? You have your test environment. The consumer is wired up to the simulated API, right? You have to remember, the consumer has no idea that this is a simulated API. As far as the consumer is concerned, it's an endpoint, right? That's it. We, as the people running the test, know that we are simulating the API because we have an isolated environment. And in the tests, what the tests will do is they will set up expectations. So the API is a simulation, right? It does not really know what to do. So you tell the API, you tell Specmatic, when you get this request, return this response. When you get this request, return this response. And Specmatic will honor your request. But before doing that, Specmatic will first validate with the various contracts that you have given to it when it started. There's this expectation with the contract. So if you say slash product slash 10 get, that request will come in and then you return a response. Specmatic will check, is there such an API? You know, is that slash 10? Is that a number as the open API spec said? Okay, and you're telling me, your test is telling me to return some response. Okay, does that meet the structure as specified for that API in the open API contract? Okay, great. And then the test moves ahead, actually hits the consumer, and test may pass or fail depending on how the consumer behaves. But if that simulation is wrong, if the expectation is wrong, Specmatic will immediately give the feedback to the test, and the test fails right there. I'll show you a demo of how this works very shortly. I have a small sample application that essentially small HTML UI, it's any small e-commerce application hitting a backend, which is for that UI, which in turn hits an order API. We are not really focusing on the backend UI today. Most importantly, I'm at this point, I'm going to show you first how we are stubbing out the order API using a contract which has been fed to Specmatic. And we will see some tests running against the backend UI that hits the contract. Let me now switch to my code. You can see here the API that, this is the spec that I was showing you on my screen before. You know, you can see all this interesting detail. And let me take you through, for example, for those who have not seen OpenAPI, it's a really good standard for describing HTTP APIs, right? Product details, for example, you know, you can look at this. I specify a name, string, type. Type itself has is an enum, if I remember correctly in this case. The type is an enum that takes various values, etc. Right? All of this information is here.
Feedback here that can you zoom the screen a bit?
Okay. Yeah, thanks, Sagar. So this is your specification. This contains all the details. This is essentially your contract. This is the starting point for your development. You don't start development basically either the API or the consumer until this specification is ready, right? And then once this is ready, let me show you how the tests are run. We are using Karate for these tests. And the Karate, we've written a small Karate helper. The Karate helper essentially executes the tests in this file, which I will show you in a moment. And before executing the test in this file, we are starting up Specmatic itself. Specmatic here has been configured. Specmatic has been configured with the needed contracts that it is going to stub out. So this is the order API v1 file that I showed you a moment ago. And we are going to see how that stubbing out happens. So I'm going to run these tests, right? I'm just going to run these tests, and while the tests are running, I will show you how the API tests actually look. Let's look at our first test, right? What we are telling Specmatic here, this is Karate to say, this is the URL we are going to use. We are going to make a request to this URL, and this is Specmatic expectations. We are basically telling Specmatic, you know, expect/products. The query parameter will be type and value will be gadget. And this is my response, right? And Specmatic has validated this response and actually checked that it matches the contract. So for example, what happens if this...
No, were sorry to interrupt you. Yeah. Could you zoom in a bit?
Zoom in again.
Naresh is just asking to zoom in. Yeah.
Thanks.
I hope this is clear. Thank you.
This is clear. Yeah, thank you. So essentially, what happens if this is wrong, right? We'll see that later. But we have just told Specmatic, expect this request, return this response. Specmatic has accepted it. And now we hit our API. This is the component we are actually testing. This is the system under test. We are getting this product type from the data-driven tests, which is a feature of Karate. The product type is here, gadget. There are a bunch of other values that we're using for validation. We get a response. Internally, what's happened is our system under test has actually hit the Specmatic service, the virtual service, has got a response back. That response was this, right? And so it was able to, you know, do its processing and return some value back. And the same with the other tests. So there is this two-step process where first you set up the expectation on Specmatic, and then you make an API call to your system under service, which is going to call its downstream, which happens to be Specmatic again, right? And this is beautiful because suddenly this test is completely under control. The downstream is completely under control. Nothing can possibly go wrong because Specmatic is running locally. So I'm not affected by network availability. I can literally do this entire work coding completely offline. I can write all my tests also completely offline. I don't have to worry about the fact that my staging environment is unavailable. What then prevents the API from drifting away from this contract, right? Because all of this is of no use. I can adhere to the contract perfectly well, and the API drifts away from it, and we are back to square one, right? And I will show you how this works. This is the API project. The API project essentially runs contract tests. So it's symmetric, right? On the consumer side, you don't have the API. You need to simulate that. On the API side, you don't have the consumer. You need to simulate the consumer. You simulate the consumer using contract tests. Where do the tests come from? Let me run the tests. Essentially, there is a very specific, a very similar file here, which basically contains this line here. It's the same spec file. It's the same YAML file, basically. This is an artifact of Specmatic that basically imports the YAML file. So I will show you, you know, that another time. But it's really the same YAML file that we are using. And these contract tests have been generated from the YAML file. All of these requests and responses essentially come from that YAML file, right? The way the YAML file works here is, I was saying, this is how it's imported, right? So the YAML file is imported in this spec file wrapper. And why the spec file wraps the YAML file is it takes all that wonderful structure, the request and response and all of that. It takes the request structure for each API call, combines it with some values. So you get an actual request, makes the API call to your API, gets the response back and validates that it meets the response, right? And by running contract tests against your API, thus simulating the consumer, and by running contract stubs, which is to say service virtualization using stubs on the consumer side, thus simulating the API, you are able to make sure that both sides, the consumer's expectations of how the API works are in sync with the contract. And you also know that the API is not going to break those expectations. And that is how you make sure that the two will not break when they are actually put together into an integration environment. So just a quick demo of what happens when you try to set an expectation the wrong way. We know, for example, that typo is supposed to be a gadget. There are certain set of values that are expected, and furniture is not a valid expectation. You're not supposed to be able to set type to furniture. And if I run the API test now, you should basically see some breakage, and the breakage will come from Specmatic. The breakage will come from Specmatic because Specmatic will highlight this test has failed, right? Specmatic is itself highlighting here a 400 request, basically saying that there is a problem, right? I won't go into this, but Specmatic has broken the test. The system under test itself did not get a chance to run. So that's a quick summary of how Specmatic works and how we use contract-driven development to be able to test your consumer in isolation. So you don't have the problems of a staging environment. You test your API in isolation as well. So that also avoids the problems of a staging environment. And then when you actually put it to a staging environment, you can be sure that they will integrate. One quick note here is we have to share the same contract across the board. That's the whole point of this, is that you're using the same contract everywhere, right? There is no point in having separate copies of the contracts because then those copies will drift apart from each other, and then you've lost the plot again. So to make sure that we have the same copy of the contract wherever we use it, what we have done in Jio is we have introduced a central contract Git repository. This is a Git repository, essentially. Contracts are nothing but text files. And so you can pretty much put the contract there. This same repository is leveraged by the consumer as well as the API team. And so both of them are able to stay in sync. There is a lot more here, which I don't know if I have time to cover right now, because we have also what happens now when you change the contract, right? The changed contract is going to affect the consumer and the API. That impacts your backward compatibility. So there are ways to handle that using Specmatic. Perhaps you can catch up with us in the hangout later after the talk. You can also visit the Specmatic website. That's specmatic.in. I don't have a link here, but if you do a quick search on GitHub for this tool, you will find it. And then there is API versioning as well. What happens when you want to introduce a backward compatible change? You will have to handle that by using API versioning. That's another topic by itself. So that's essentially it. To bring the story back and tie it back to this diagram, what we've essentially done is we have used Specmatic, the big orange bar on the right-hand side, that's Specmatic. That is simulating Hybris, Graph, Postgre, Mazuda, any MAS, all of these systems. And there's a set of services within our team that when they need to talk to these external systems, they they essentially talk to the specmatic stub. And these external systems also run these contract tests. This ensures that things are in sync when we actually put these systems into a common environment. Over to you, Sagar.
Thanks, Joel. I'll just stop the screen share, so I will just take over.
Yeah. Sorry, seem to have a...
Just let me know once my screen is visible. Okay. So now, as Joel have like talked a lot of things about service virtualization. So now what different or disruptive as part of Jio we are doing? So that is basically we are shifting the contract driven development not only to backend, but getting it onto the front end application as well. That is the first thing we are doing. Secondly, we have created an entire isolated environment for application under test. I'm not talking about service under test, but it's the entire application ecosystem under test. So it can be change at any layer, be it a database change, be it change on the consumer processor part, any of the microservice, their impact on the client application can be tested in isolation. And the power is provided by stubbing, intelligent stubbing powered by Specmatic. So again, I will just reiterate that this dotted line, which goes from your test to Specmatic, is the key of driving this entire test automation ecosystem. You can set dynamic expectations, and at the same time, you can have validation done on your client side. What is that you want to see? So Joel have quite talked on the central contract repository piece, but I will just take a minute more to give you more details on how, as a pipeline process, we keep our contracts in sync. So every service or UI repository have got a reference file, which contains the contract used or the external system API calls used by that service or application. Whenever the build happens, we create two artifacts. One is the latest copy of contract from the central repository, and other is the build artifact. Now this get all through the static code analysis check. Now, as part of the deploy contract bundle stage, all this contract, latest copy of the contracts get deployed onto the Specmatic server, so that when my automated tests run, they always run against the recent contract. If any of the external team make a breaking change, my automation script will not run against old contract and pass, but it will fail, giving me an update right in the lower environment, not in the integration environment. So just a small glimpse of it. Now, as part of demo, I'm trying to replicate a scenario which I talked while talking on the drawback front. There is an external service, and one of the API wanted to give me a failure. So as an end user, I am trying to place an order on, like I have to place an order, but upstream system is not working. So I will not see credit option. Like I cannot place an order on credit, but I should at least see other payment options so that my tier one flow doesn't break. So this is something which is a very important part of testing, because in production, if that API goes down, your ordering flow should not be impacted. And that is kind of on tier one flow. So as a flow, what Appium test does is it sets a expectation on the Specmatic server, the big arrow, saying, okay, if you get a request for Jio, then just reply back with status code 500. And then it triggers the UI flow on the client APK. Now client APK calls internal service, which is internal to our application. internal service triggers a call to external service, which in this case is a Specmatic server. And now, as we have already told our Specmatic server during runtime that if a request comes with this request body or for this particular phone number, you return a 500 response code. Now, this is dynamic in nature. That's why all the parallel running tests will not get 500. Only this particular request will get a 500 response code. The backend will process and send a failure to the client application. And client application will show the desired behavior, which would be validated by our APM test. I will quickly move to the demo piece of it from the code. So as you can see, what similar to Joel have showed you, we have a JSON blob which says what would be the method which will come to you. Like basically a get request will come to you. Path is blank because we will set it at runtime key. What would be the path, because it would be dependent on phone number, the merchant phone number. And then what response and status code to expect. Now this is a template which we have already created. From our test case, so this is basically the test case where you say this is a typical BDD driven framework. So I will log in, I will search for a product. I will again zoom in so that everybody, the things get visible for everyone. I search for a product, I add that product to the cart, I verify, and now I verify that the credit option is not available. When the external system or the external API, sorry, not the system, but the API itself is down. At the same time, I verify other payment options are displayed. So this is a typical test case, which if you talk on integration environment, very difficult to replicate this scenario. And at the same time, this is a perfect candidate for a known unknown category. Even if you test such cases, you would be testing it at the very last leg of your testing cycle. Now, if you see here, you can see that we are setting an expectation for the request. It will read that template and set a failure response. Just move this. Now this piece of code actually does the magic for us, where we say path would be this, the path which the external system or the internal system will send, the merchant mobile number, what status I expect, the message success should be false and message should be internal server error, status code 500 and result should be null, like we should not get any result. So I will try to I will run this test case for you for a while, but I'm not sure because in lieu of time, this test would run on an emulator. But meanwhile, the test is compiling and other thing is doing. So what is going to happen is, so if you see my application, will post a request saying I want to get the merchant details, and they will get the response failed to fetch summary details or 500 response code. I go to overview, I can see the status would be 500. So basically this message comes from an internal service which gets a message from a external service or a mock server. So if there is any problem with either the application forming the request or backend processing the response, both can be captured as part of this flow, and you can test both the front end and back end in isolation without having any dependency on an external system. To get it more clear, because we currently lack time, so I will just directly go to the report part of this. So we log all the report on report portal. So when this test get executed, you will get to see this kind of report where you can actually see what's happening. So we set expectations. These are expectation for login. This is expectation from an external system when we search for a merchant. All these things happening, and then we try to trigger our login flow.
Sagar, just a heads up, 5 more minutes for the call.
Sure.
Thank you.
Yes. So we validate. We have finally logged in. And before we open for Q&A, I'll just show you. Okay. This is where we have set the expectation as we want a 500 response code from external service. And we validate the behavior on UI. That we can see this cash on delivery option, but we cannot see a credit option. This is typically what we have done so far. That is, we shifted the entire UI testing on the left hand side. I think without much more delay, I want to open the stage for Q&A. I think we already have some things on the Q&A part of it. So, okay, I think we can take Q&A one by one. There are questions on Specmatic. Joel, can you take those questions?
Yeah, I'll just read them out. There are like around 3 questions. Is Specmatic open source?
Yes, Specmatic is fully open source.
Okay. And the next question, is there an automated way to generate this contract?
At this point in time, we don't have an automated way to generate OpenAPI contracts, but I think we are looking at doing something along these lines at some point in the future.
And one more question is, but can you have dynamic templates in Specmatic, maybe with some logic? For example, if a response needs to include something from a request, like some IDs or calculate something from a request, for example, add 2 integers and put it in a response.
So I'd like to actually add one more thing on the previous question briefly. I will come to this as well. I understand the question here. Although we don't although we don't auto-generate contracts, there is this very nice tool called Stoplight Studio. You can do a quick Google search and look for it. Stoplight Studio is really powerful. It's a nice GUI and it makes it very easy for you to write OpenAPI contracts. To answer the second question about dynamically, making changes. So Specmatic currently includes certain matches. If, for example, you want to just match any number, you can do that. Usually the expectation is that most of the time you will know what your application is about to ask for. And you will know then what kind of value the request is going to look like. And from that, what response is expected to be. I think it will be good to actually have an example of this. So maybe you can catch up with us later in the Hangout. And we can look at this in a little bit more depth. How does Specmatic handle API versioning? I think in this context, Specmatic basically treats APIs as files. So we have a static check basically for backward compatibility. It's pretty simple to use. And essentially it tells you, so there are certain thumb rules, right? If, for example, you add a compulsory parameter in your request, which was never expected to be sent before, you know for a fact you're immediately going to break all your downstream consumers, right? This can be statically checked, and Specmatic has a simple backward compatible check to check this out, to sort of get this feedback. And the rule of thumb here is that if you are introducing a backward compatible change, bump up the API version. Specmatic handles versioning by just the file name. So you essentially have probably V1 in the file name, and the new file name will have V2. And then the respective consumers and providers are expected to stay on track with those respective contract files. How are you mapping mocked API to the mobile app? I'm not able to fully answer this this one, but okay, I think I can briefly say that there is a descriptor file. There is a descriptor file called specmatic.json that contains all of the downstreams that your application would want to stub out. So the mobile application will have to declare its downstreams inside that file. And similarly, the actual API will have to declare the contracts that it adheres to. But essentially, that's how your mobile application will declare its contracts, and that's how the mapping works. I'm not sure if I fully answered that question though.
Joel, I will just also take a while on that.
Yeah.
So basically, at least as part of the Jio ecosystem, the application which we test is a interfacing application between the external world and the client application. So whatever request is originated from the mobile app, it first comes to our internal services, which are all actual in our isolated environment. And later, all the upstream systems for those microservices are stubbed using Specmatic. So that's where basically all the mocking is being taken care of by the backend services. And we, as per the app, doesn't consider of mocking anything. They just call actual APIs, which they would be calling in higher environment as well for the internal services. And that is what is different, what we are doing from all others in this industry or in terms of mocking. If you need more details, we can talk on the Hangout session.
Right. And final question, I think if we have time, but it looks like the last question. We are stubbing external services, but say I want to stub an API service and consider my consumer UI and get responses from the stub. Absolutely, you can do that. You can actually stub any service. The fact that it was an external service here was because of the approach that we are taking. But you can pretty much stub out any API. And in fact, that is exactly what that's one of the things we are doing at Jio as well. The stubbing out, we are writing tests for one of our mobile apps that stubs out its downstream APIs using Specmatic, and this test can run from the desktop itself. In fact, that was also Sagar's demo. So I think that might answer your question.
Thank you, Sagar. Thank you, Joel, for sharing experience with us today.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks for joining. Thank you for being patient, audience. Thank you.